It's my pleasure to thank you all for joining us today for this very important symposium on cybersecurity. URI is pleased to host this event on behalf of Congressman Langevin, who as one of our nation's experts in the field of cybersecurity, serves as a key member of Congress in matters related to this topic. We have a very full schedule today with 22 presentations across three focus sessions. But first, we will hear from URI President David Dooley, from Congressman James Langevin, from Senator Sheldon Whitehouse, and then we will have the keynote address by General Keith Alexander, who serves as the Director of the National Security Agency and the U.S. Cyber Command. Speakers in the three focus sessions represent federal agencies and federal departments that include the Department of Homeland Security, the FBI Cyber Division, the U.S. IRS, and also includes DARPA. Included also are speakers representing our private and public sector partners and URI faculty and student researchers who will discuss how their research bears on critical cybersecurity issues of the day. Let me point out also that during our lunch session, URI students will be standing by their posters that highlight their research on topics relevant to cybersecurity, and I encourage you all to spend some time with them. One thing you're going to find out today is one of the unique things we have at URI is that we actually have academic programs in place that bear on cybersecurity. So now, at this time, I am very pleased to introduce President David Dooley, who became the 11th president of the University of Rhode Island in July of 2009. Throughout his career, he has maintained a high level of his own research that actually continues to this day with funding from both the National Institutes of Health and also from the National Science Foundation. Dr. Dooley brings to URI a very collaborative leadership style that promotes the full engagement of the university with the people that we serve. In particular, he understands that resources, he understands the resources that URI, as a land-grant and sea-grant public research flagship university, brings to bear on the critical issues that our state, our region, and our nation face during these very challenging times. While his tenure as at URI, as the president of our university, has been relatively short, he is widely recognized throughout the state as a leader who fully supports the URI missions in research, education, outreach, economic and workforce development, in broad areas of fields that also include cybersecurity. So please join me in welcoming President Dooley.
Thank you, Peter, and thanks to all of you for attending today. We're delighted to host what we think is a very important event, not just for Rhode Island, but for our nation and our nation's interests in a host of different ways. I think we stand at a moment that in many respects is unprecedented, when we've come to realize, I think with increasing intensity, the necessity of thinking about the subjects encompassed by cybersecurity and recognize that it touches not just defense and homeland security, but it touches education, it touches business, and it touches all the critical infrastructure components of our nation, and that we have collectively a number of challenges to overcome if we're to build the kind of security that I think we need and that our people deserve. I think times like these call more than any other kind of set of circumstances for collaboration, cooperation, and participation broadly across the sectors of government, of education, and of business and community and state and local affairs. And I think what we see today is that that commitment exists here in Rhode Island. And it's really a pleasure to see the interest, the expertise, and the commitment that exists in this small state and at this university and the other universities and institutions within Rhode Island to step forward and to be a full partner and participant in defining both the challenges more accurately and the remedies that we will need to implement in order to protect the security of our way of life, which is essentially what we're all here to do. So thank you very much for joining us today. I think it'll be a rich day. I think it'll be a productive and fruitful day. And I think it'll be a day that at the end of it, we will say was time well spent and that we are now prepared with new energy and new commitment to go forward and tackle some of the challenges that we can define more clearly in our conversations and discussions today. Thank you.
We have some special guests here with us today, and I'd like to point them out. First, we have Representative Raymond Hull from the Providence District Number 6. You might stand or wave if you're here so we can see you. Way in the back. Thank you, sir. We also have Vladimir Hybera from the Office of the Lieutenant Governor, General Coyne, who serves as the Deputy Attorney General. Thank you all for coming. From URI, we have Robert Beagle, who's the Vice President for University Advancement, Don DeHaze, who's our Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs. I see Don here. Thomas Dugan, who's the Vice President for Student Affairs, and Robert Wagan, who's the Vice President for Administration and Finance. And also, we have some of our deans with us. We have Dean Wendy Brownell, who's the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, Raymond Wright, the Dean of the College of Engineering, and Mark Higgins, the Dean of the College of Business Administration. I see two of them over there, so if you would wave so people know who you are. Thank you very much. It's my honor now to introduce Congressman James Langevin. Congressman Langevin has served in the U.S. House of Representatives since the year 2000, where he represents the Rhode Island 2nd Congressional District. He is widely recognized as a national and party leader on national security, health care, and stem cell research. In particular, protecting our national and economic security from cyber threats has been one of his top priorities. Congressman Langevin serves on the House Armed Services Committee, where he is the ranking member of the Emerging Threats and Capabilities Subcommittee, and serves on the subcommittees on Sea Power and Projection Forces and Strategic Force. He is serving his third term on the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence and is a member of the Subcommittee on Technical and Tactical Intelligence. In 2008, the Congressman was honored to serve as co-chair of the Center for Strategic and International Studies Commission on Cybersecurity for the 44th Presidency. Following the release of this report, Congressman Langevin introduced comprehensive cybersecurity legislation. Congressman Langevin strongly believes that good intelligence is the nation's first line of defense against terrorism and other national security threats. Please join me in welcoming the Honorable James Langevin.
Thank you. Peter, thank you very much, and good morning, everyone. Let me say what an outstanding crowd this is, and I've been looking forward to this symposium for quite some time now. I understand that General Alexander, who'll be speaking in a bit, is on his way, someone I've been privileged to know for quite some time, and you're in for a great keynote address here this morning. But let me begin, of course, by welcoming you to the URI Cybersecurity Symposium, and I, in particular, would like to thank President Dooley for hosting this event. Your commitment and leadership on this and other important education issues are a real inspiration, and I have been proud to work with you since you've arrived here at the University of Rhode Island on our shared priorities, and look forward to our continued collaboration. Let me also thank the URI team, headed by Dr. Alfonso, for planning this event. And of course, I have to recognize my colleague, Senator Sheldon Whitehouse, who has been a real partner with me in this effort to secure the nation's cyber critical infrastructure as he's conducted his work in the, on the Senate side. It's been a real partnership. And of course, as I said, General Alexander, who is both the director of NSA and the first now head of the newly created Cyber Command, which is in charge of protecting the .mil network. And I want to thank, of course, all the distinguished panelists and speakers who you'll be hearing from during the rest of the day as well. Ladies and gentlemen, because of our growing reliance on cyberspace for critical services, national defense, and daily needs, as well as the open and trusting architecture of the internet that adversaries are trying to exploit, our country faces increasing challenges from threats online. These threats include targeting our critical infrastructure, exposing citizens to identity theft, and attacking the systems which protect our sensitive classified information. This situation is made even more difficult by the fact that these already challenging and complex threats are growing in dynamic ways, making it nearly impossible for us to stay ahead of the thousands of new attacks or vulnerabilities that are discovered literally every day. Perhaps one of the most significant changes in our culture, of course, over the past decade has been the extent to which the American public is discovering the profound effects of the internet on their daily lives. From accessing our bank accounts on our computers to connecting to social networks from our phones, our reliance on the internet affects every aspect of our life and does so at an increasingly early age. I recently attended an assembly of 238th graders in Johnston. I asked them how many of them had a Facebook page, and almost every hand when the room went up. Well, because of this shift in our society, serious new vulnerabilities, though, have also emerged. In 2010 alone, researchers recorded 662 breaches at large companies or federal agencies that left exposed 16.2 million records. This data enables cyber criminals to prey on citizens and companies, with some estimates putting the cost of cyber threats and cyber theft to our economy at approximately $8 billion annually. But these threats don't just come from cyber criminals. It's estimated that there are also approximately 1.8 billion attacks on our government servers every month. Well, in February, I attended a hearing where the director of the CIA and the director of the National Intelligence described our susceptibility to cyber terrorist attacks that could, in fact, shut down government agencies, power grids, or financial markets. Now, while we have not yet seen the worst weapons in the hands of the worst actors, Director Panetta noted that, and I quote, "The potential for the next Pearl Harbor could very well be a cyber attack." Well, as a member of both the House Armed Services Committee and the House Intelligence Committee, I've seen firsthand how securing our networks against hackers, terrorists, organized crime, and foreign powers has become an ever greater component of our national and economic security strategies. This is particularly important, as many have noted that countries such as Russia, China, and Iran are also focused on investing significant resources into cyber capabilities. Now, from the government's perspective, we have the challenge of defending both .mil and the .gov networks. Our military, to this answer to this, has just stood up the newly created Cyber Combatant Command led by NSA Director General Alexander, as I mentioned earlier, to protect our military networks. Beyond this, the Department of Homeland Security has also been increasing their efforts to protect federal civilian systems with the hard work of people like Doug Maughan. Every day, both of these agencies have hundreds of dedicated men and women working incredibly hard to develop solutions to protect our military and federal networks from attack. However, today, our nation still stands largely unprepared to deal with these very real threats. The government currently has only a limited role in offering assistance to private owners of our critical infrastructure and .com networks. And we're also struggling with how to defend critical systems while protecting our civil liberties and privacy, which is vitally important. Adding to these challenges, there's no one single person or office with the proper authorities leading our government's efforts to keep our network safe. As co-chair of the Center for Strategic and International Studies Commission on Cybersecurity, as well as the various committees and other work that I do with the United States Congress, I've spoken out countless times about these deficiencies and have called for reform. Now, while some meaningful progress has been made over the past few years, some of these same challenges remain unsolved, and many of our nation's networks continue to be vulnerable. I'm working with many people, including leaders like Senator Whitehouse, as I mentioned earlier, to bring our nation in line with our technological realities facing us online. Now, to this point, I've introduced legislation that would protect our critical infrastructure and work to address current weaknesses in our security policy by increasing coordination among federal agencies and between the public and private sectors. My proposal establishes one national office with the proper policy and budgetary authorities to oversee cybersecurity. This legislation also ensures that the government and military can acquire the best technology and undergo regular reviews to evaluate their performance. However, all the best ideas won't keep us secure without the right people to execute them. And our nation's cyber workforce is currently not large enough to match the scale of these threats. Experts have estimated that the U.S. has fewer than 1,000 people that can compete at world-class level with the advanced security skills to effectively compete in cyberspace. But the reality is that we need somewhere between 20 and 30,000 people. The cornerstone of this effort begins in the classroom, from our secondary schools to places like URI's Digital Forensics Center. Rhode Island has a strong history of working to protect and serve our nation. With the talent that we are developing in our universities, high-tech industry, and local military community, I know that we stand ready to rise to this challenge. We also look to strengthen Rhode Island's economy, which continues to have, as we know, one of the highest unemployment rates in the nation. This challenge also offers the opportunity to increase sustainable job growth opportunities. Last year, I hosted the Rhode Island Summit on the Economy, or RISE. The goal of this event was to bring together leaders in the state to brainstorm the best paths to economic recovery. Over the course of the day, two common themes emerged. We need to close the skills gap for the jobs that are out there in our state, and we must encourage collaboration between the business and education sectors so that we bring the 21st century jobs and technologies here to Rhode Island. This symposium is a way to bring together local businesses and regional academic partners. I believe that we must harness the talent and the creativity of students at institutions like URI and incorporate the perspectives of public and private entities to build a competitive cyber workforce that meets our national security needs. In order to strengthen the pipeline for these jobs, we need to engage all of our state's schools, businesses, colleges and universities, and other invested partners in a common goal. Cyber skills should be a core fundamental of the science, technology, engineering, and math fields, or STEM fields, which are critical to improving our country's innovation. Rhode Island can be a leader in this effort, along with partners including the Rhode Island Department of Education, STAC, and Tech Collective. I helped launch a cyber program to foster computer security skills at the high school level. The Rhode Island Cyber Foundation's competition, as one headline stated, and I quote, aims to make cyber geeks cool, end quote. And we want to show basically the next generation that an interest in computers is not just a hobby, it can also become a career. Over 140 students from 18 high schools across the state signed up for the initial six-week challenge, which ended this past Friday. By partnering with others in the cyber community, we hope this competition will grow into a model for developing young talent. In Rhode Island, we, I know, have the drive to rise to this national security and workforce challenge. URI has been a leader, training students to secure the information infrastructure of government, private companies, nonprofits, and academia. The school has produced notable alumni, including the Deputy Chief of the FBI Cyber Division. Building on their accomplishments, we can help our local economy by creating jobs and supporting an industry that is in great demand right now. We need institutions like URI, and we need all of you in this room here today. I hope you're able to learn from our distinguished speakers and to discuss these issues among your colleagues sitting around you today and to find opportunities for collaboration. Just as President Kennedy rallied the nation to meet the challenges of access to space, we must be ready to really to rally around and meet the new challenges facing our nation online. We have the talent in Rhode Island and across the nation to help us get there. I'm excited to get started for what lies ahead for our nation's national security and also for our state's cyber workforce. With that, I want to thank all of you for being here today, and I look forward to an exciting symposium. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I couldn't help but notice that he pointed out that we need 20 to 30,000 trained workforce in this country to deal with that. And one of the things we'll see as the day goes out, passes on, that our faculty here at UConn are in place to do just that, to help us fill this huge gap. So at this time, it's my honor to introduce U.S. Senator Sheldon Whitehouse. Senator Whitehouse has served in the United States Senate since the year 2007. He sits on the Budget Committee, the Environment and Public Works Committee, the Judiciary Committee, the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, and the Special Committee on Aging. He chairs the Judiciary Subcommittee on Crime and Terrorism and the EPW Subcommittee on Oversight. In regard to cybersecurity, Senator Whitehouse served as the member of the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence and served as the chairman of the Cyber Task Force. In this capacity, he worked on passage of the Intelligence Authorization Bill, which provides enhanced oversight of our nation's efforts to combat cyber threats. Please join me in welcoming the Honorable Sheldon Whitehouse.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you all for being here. President Dooley, thank you very much for putting the resources of our great university to this important task. Let me welcome General Alexander. We are thrilled to have him here in Rhode Island. He works very closely with Congressman Langevin and myself. We don't often get 4 stars here, so it's pretty exciting. But as closely as he's worked with Jim and with me, he also has an important relationship with Senator Reed, who used to be his company commander long before those 4 stars grew onto his shoulders. So we have a very good Rhode Island relationship with General Alexander. But I want to particularly compliment Congressman Langevin. His work on this is really extraordinary. He has been on the House Intelligence Committee, the Washington acronym is HPSI, for many years. He has worked very hard on this. He has co-founded the House Cybersecurity Caucus, which he still co-chairs. If you look at the literature on cybersecurity, one of the foundational documents is the CSIS Commission on Cybersecurity Report for the 44th President. Jim was its co-author. And so we are very, very fortunate to have his great leadership in this area, and I'm very proud to work with him. Where are we? Well, it appears that the Obama administration is coming to the end of its year-long interagency process on cybersecurity, and they will soon be prepared to re-engage with Congress on this issue. This is timely, as the threat is serious and action to protect our country is overdue. In the Senate, the Commerce Committee, led by Chairman Rockefeller and Senator Snow, both of whom also serve on our Intelligence Committee, reported out its bill on March 24, 2010. The Homeland Security Committee, led by Chairman Lieberman and Senator Collins, reported out its bill on June 24, 2010. The Intelligence Committee Cybersecurity Task Force completed its classified report on July 1, 2010, authored by me, Senator Barbara Mikulski, and Senator Snow. So we are ready in the Senate. We hope to do a major bill this year, and when we do, I know that Congressman Langevin's legislation will be an important and foundational document. The urgency here is pressing. Malicious actors in cyberspace have already caused significant damage to the U.S. government, the U.S. economy, and U.S. citizens. U.S. government computer networks are probed millions of times each day. Approximately 9 million Americans have their identities stolen each year. Cybercrime costs American businesses with 500 or more employees nearly $4 million per year each. And intellectual property worth over $1 trillion has already been stolen from American businesses. I contend that we are on the losing end of the biggest transfer of wealth in history as the result of theft and piracy. Recent public reports disclose major hacks into Google, DuPont, NASDAQ, and the email marketing company Epsilon. A recent McAfee report on Night Dragon attacks on the U.S. energy sector states the following, and I'll read it briefly because you don't often get something this clear that's not classified or held as proprietary. In 2010, we entered a new decade in the world of cybersecurity. This decade is setting up to be the exponential jumping off point. The adversaries are rapidly leveraging productized malware toolkits that let them develop more malware than in all prior years combined. And they have matured from the prior decade to release the most insidious and persistent cyber threats ever known. Starting in November 2009, coordinated covert and targeted cyber attacks have been conducted against global oil, energy, and petrochemical companies. These attacks have involved social engineering, spear phishing attacks, exploitation of Microsoft Windows operating system vulnerabilities, Microsoft Active Directory compromises, and the use of remote administration tools in targeting and harvesting sensitive competitive proprietary operations and project financing information with regard to oil and gas field bids and operations. We have identified, says McAfee, the tools, techniques, and network activities used in these continuing attacks, which we have dubbed Night Dragon. The methods and tools used in these attacks are able to evade detection by standard security software and network policies. We've been able to determine that a dedicated effort has been going on for at least 2 years, and likely as many as four. Well-coordinated, targeted attacks such as Night Dragon, orchestrated by a growing group of malicious attackers committed to their targets, are rapidly on the rise. These targets have now moved beyond the defense industrial base, government, and military computers to include global, corporate, and commercial targets. While the Night Dragon attacks focus specifically on the energy sector, the tools and techniques of this kind can be highly successful when targeting any industry. Our experience has shown that many other industries are currently vulnerable and are under continuous and persistent cyber espionage attacks of this type. More and more, these attacks focus not on using and abusing machines within the organizations being compromised, but rather on the theft of specific data and intellectual property. It is a sobering report. In the course of my work, I've been talking with leading CEOs about this issue. One green energy CEO reported to me that when a press report came out about a new product that they had developed, his personal email was attacked 60,000 times in the next 2 hours. 40,000 of those attacks originated in China. He described in live action them trying to put up their defenses as the attacks on the firewalls were coming through the other side. The CEO of a household name internet company, a company whose services you probably use every day, knows well what it's like out there on the world wide web. And I asked him, describe it. Give me an analogy. Is it like, say, a nice small town into which from time to time a bad guy rides and the marshal has to go out on Main Street at noon to face him down? Or is it like a town that is threatened from time to time by a wild bunch that rides into town and that eventually gets cleared out? Or is it like my son's video game with zombies at every window trying to tear their way in as fast as you can shoot them down and board up the windows? Definitely the zombies, he said, or worse. So we have a real issue on our hands here, and it touches Americans' lives in so many ways. Cyber attacks can shut off the electricity in your house, can knock out your cell phone and your laptop, can shut down the ATM you go to for cash, can compromise the very bank records that allow banks to transact business, can compromise the credit and debit networks over which retail stores get paid when they sell us groceries and goods, and even interfere with the law enforcement and first responder communications so necessary to help us get through an attack. So that leaves real issues for us to address. I list them as follows. One, we can't have our cyber vulnerabilities be our nation's dirty big secret any longer. Both government and the private sector have to come a lot cleaner about our exposure and come from out from behind the veil of classified and proprietary secrecy. Two, there have to be basic rules of the road on our information superhighways. We don't allow cars to travel on our geographic superhighways with headlights out, with mufflers dragging at excessive rates of speed, yet we allow computers dripping with malware, enslaved to botnets, unrestricted access on most of the information highway. Our American industries need to be empowered in self-defense, like the old prairie wagons who would circle together when attacked, so that they can energetically and well-informedly engage in their own protection. We need cyber 911. Who do you call when your CIO is overwhelmed if you're a local bank or utility? Specifically, how can we pre-position defenses for our critical infrastructure? Since these attacks come at the speed of light, worms and viruses can lurk silently in systems, and some attacks can only be defeated if they are prevented. By the time that cyber 911 calls, it can be too late. And finally, what do we need to do to resource and ready our public safety agencies for this new theater of operations? Does law enforcement really have what it needs? If we translated the laws of war, the principles of sovereignty, and the conventions of covert operations from geographic into cyberspace in a way that telegraphs to our enemies what we'll tolerate and what we won't. The Cold War was won after a long, sustained campaign of deterrence. What wall of deterrence protects us in cyberspace? We've got work to do, real work, on which the safety and security of our economy and our nation can depend, and we had better get cracking. And I appreciate what URI has done to make this happen, and I appreciate particularly our Congressman's extraordinary leadership in Washington on this issue, Congressman Jim Langevin. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. Well, if we had any doubt before, we clearly understand the magnitude of this problem, and it's just huge. And, it's my privilege now to introduce our keynote speaker this morning, General Keith B. Alexander, who serves as the director of the National Security Agency and is chief of the NSA Central Security Service and commander of the U.S. Cyber Command. As the director of NSA and the chief of Central Security Service, he is responsible for the Department of Defense agency with national foreign intelligence, combat support, and U.S. national security security information system protection responsibilities. There are NSA and CSA civilian and military personnel stationed worldwide. As commander of U.S. Cyber Command, he is responsible for planning, coordinating, and conducting operations and defense of DoD networks. General Alexander entered active duty at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point and has held numerous leadership positions in service to our country. He was confirmed by the U.S. Senate for appointment to the rank of general, that's full general with 4 stars, in the year 2010. We are very pleased that General Alexander was able to take his time. You can imagine all the things that this man has on his plate, to take his time from his many critical duties to visit with us today. So please join me in welcoming General Keith Alexander.
There you go. You know, let me be real honest. Thank you for that great introduction, but the way the Army promotes people is alphabetically. I know that. So let's be honest about this. Two, it's an honor and privilege to be here. First, my hat's off to Congressman Langevin for what you've done for our country in cybersecurity. I know Senator Whitehouse had talked about this, but you know, two things, when you look at it from my perspective, I think cybersecurity is one of the most important issues facing our nation today. Senator Langevin led, co-founded the first ever Congressional Cybersecurity Caucus in 2008, and then co-chaired the CSIS Commission on Cybersecurity for the 44th President. Absolutely superb. And perhaps more importantly, he's looked at this, he's studied this, he's been a leader in the House. And sir, thank you very much for what you do. It's interesting that Rhode Island, not just the university, but your elected officials lead in this area. As Senator Whitehouse, as you heard, he has tremendous depth as well. You would be very proud to know that your state leads in this area. And Senator Whitehouse, thank you for what you've done. I know on the Senate Select Committee for Intelligence, you led that panel. You did a superb job. You were one of the few people that I've ever seen go in and really study and get to the ground too. So let's give him a big round of applause, please. Okay, I've got to remember to push the advance button. I know this on these things here. So I'll try to remember that. But before I do, I brought with us
We also have at the National Security Agency, we have a graduate from the University of Rhode Island, I think in 1886. Am I off a little? December. Yeah, he was in December. 1986 class. Steve, please stand up. Steve Ryan. Now, the reason I had him stand up is he's one of the architects for cybersecurity at the National Security Agency and has led the development of defensive sensors for our nation. Absolutely superb. You ought to be proud of one of your alumni. We are proud of you, Steve, so thanks. With that, I know I'm on a timeline here, not the movie. And I'll throw some jokes in. It's okay to laugh because I get graded if they are funny. First, cybersecurity. You heard what Senator Whitehouse said. Tremendous opportunity in this space. Look at what's going on. Many of you have the new iPhones, the iPads, these mobile devices. And when you look at the amount of mobile devices, from 2000, we had about 500 million mobile phones. Now about 5 billion out there. Just about everybody on the planet has one. I guess several of you have many, and some are without. But tremendous opportunities. And look at what's going on and what this means for the future. When you look at Deep Blue up in the upper left-hand corner and Watson in the lower right-hand corner, look at what's going on in this area. We're going mobile. We're getting better capabilities, lots of applications. The opportunities are limitless. I believe that these capabilities will help us solve many of the problems we have with cancer, with other forms of disease, with how we collaborate in the future. It's the wave. It's coming. We have to be prepared for it. And I'll tell you, this is something to look forward to. You've heard all the statistics, so let me jump to the next thing. It can also be used for social networking, for setting up some things like snowball fights on the mall. Very important. It's not often you get snow on the mall. But perhaps more importantly, look at what's happened in the Middle East. When you look at Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, the use of social network forums for starting and changing leaders, a huge jump forward. And if you think about it, you're starting to see some of those leaders look at, well, how do we stop people from using these networks? So you're seeing people use them and others try to stop it. And I think that's going to be part of our future. So what I want to talk briefly about on this slide here was to introduce the threat. I'll hit off some of the key comments that Senator Whitehouse had. But when we look at the threat, look at exploitation, that's been going on for years. But it doesn't mean it's right, but it has been going on. It's getting worse. You heard the form $1 trillion. Comes from a McAfee report about the intellectual property and other forms of problems on the network, monetary problems that we face. Now, I bring up intellectual property because that's what we're losing from foreign actors in these space for industry. Our governments are losing secrets. And when you think about the companies that have been hit, NASDAQ, RSA, Google. Those are companies that you would think are at the top of cybersecurity and cyber defense. And if they get hit, where does that put companies that are in the electrical sector and other sectors of our government? It's a huge problem. If you shift that a little bit to the right and look at the middle, disruption. I had the privilege to go out to Estonia. It is a country, I can tell you that. I thought, well, perhaps the E was part of Estonia, and it was just a virtual place, but it's a real country. And I met with President Ilves. In fact, we sat on a panel this weekend. They got hit in 2007 in Tallinn, the monument, the Soviet monument that was taken down. This was a diplomatic, political agenda. The Estonians were taking down that. The Russians didn't want that to go down. They were hit with a massive distributed denial of service attack. Now, that's a disruption because that's like that one person who Senator Whitehouse said 60,000 emails in 2 hours. they got hundreds of millions of emails into their system, and it disrupted their ability to communicate, took down their banking sector. They had to close off all external communications outside the country. It impacted them significantly, caused them to jump towards now for NATO, the lead for a cyber center of excellence and other things like that. But they weren't the only ones. You see under that, the little picture there of Georgia, it's hard to read perhaps from those in the back, but that's what that represents, that little fuzzy object there, which is when the Russians came into Georgia, it was uniquely accompanied by a cyber attack on the Georgian infrastructure, another disruptive attack. And Latvia, Lithuania, Kyrgyzstan, and Azerbaijan have also been hit by disruptive attacks. And those are attacks that disrupt, but once they stop, you can clean it up and get back to work. What I'm concerned about are destructive attacks, those that are coming. And I put down some unclassified examples to give you some insights from this. You know, just to give you an idea of what could happen, and some of these were not attacks, but mistakes that have happened, but it gives you some insights. The Northeast power grid problem in August of 2003 was based on software issues, where a race condition was set up when three high voltage power lines went down simultaneously. And what that did, it caused a race condition back to the central node that when it got all three at once, it went offline because that wasn't supposed to happen. And when it went offline, those inside the center assumed everything was okay. And when other lines started to go down, they didn't recognize the problem of power being drawn off. And when power started to get drawn off from other sectors, those quickly started to go down and caused the cascade to shut down the Northeast power section in 4 minutes. And you know the problems from there. The one shown on this slide is the Sasano-Shushkinskaya Dam, which is a dam in Russia, and we probably should just call it the S Dam. But I thought, well, that wouldn't be appropriate in this audience, so I tried to pronounce it. This is the third largest in the world hydroelectric dam. What happened, there was a fire in Russia, about 500 miles away. There are 10 huge hydroelectric turbines in this dam, each 640 megawatts. 640 megawatts, that's huge. And they needed one of these to come online when the other power system went off about 500 miles away. So they turned it on remotely. But what they didn't realize is the sensing system that showed when things were going off kilter when it started to spin was offline. So they had no idea that this thing was going to go start to wobble and break free of its infrastructure. Now, why would that be a concern? Well, first, those turbines weigh around 1,500 tons. 1,500 tons, and pushing through it is about 775,000 gallons of water a second. Think of that as an Olympic pool. And so when this broke free, it caused that turbine to raise up in the air about 50 feet, and when it came back down, it destroyed the other nine, killed 75 people, and all done because somebody turned it on remotely and didn't have the ability to sense that there was a problem. What I'm concerned about, these are issues that were caused by people with good intentions. What about those without? And there are two forms of the destruction that I'm concerned about. One is data, destroying data, and the other is equipment. And I think we have to be ready for both of those. 2008, the Defense Department recognized that we had malicious software, not only in our audio system, but also in our networks. In our networks, we realized that this was brought to us by our own people who used thumb drives to go from the unclassified networks to classified systems. And when they did that, they brought this malicious software. We had a number of problems on that network. It was identified by the National Security Agency's Advanced Network Ops Team. And when they recognized it, they were able to build a system in 22 hours to negate this, 22 hours. Oh, by the way, it always happens on a Friday. All problems happen on a Friday. So they came in at 16:30 on a Friday and said, here's the problem. And they had the solution, and by 14:30 on Saturday, they had it up and running. That's a huge, huge capability that our nation needs, and I'll come back and talk about that in a minute. So that was the key issue that started the United States Cyber Command. And, you know, we're not in this alone. You see that we put in here U.S. Cyber Command, the National Security Agency, and Department of Homeland Security. It takes a team to operate in this space. What I wanted to talk about a little bit on this slide was, what did we do? What did the Secretary of Defense do? We used to have our defense under the Global Network Ops, the Joint Task Force under DISA. The operate and defend were in one sector, the exploit and our offensive capabilities under NSA and the Joint Task Force, or our Joint Functional Component Command for Net Warfare. What this meant is that we had different levels of classification. NSA operates at a top secret level. Our network defenders operate at a secret level. They could not know everything that we know. And when you think about it, that would be like telling your defensive team, you're only going to get a little bit of information. We have a lot more, but we can't share it with you. That's ludicrous. So what the Secretary did is he pushed both of those joint task force together and formed U.S. Cyber Command. Now, I wanted to hit some key things that the President said in his May 29th speech, because I think this is important to this audience, and I want to get these exactly right, because what he's put out here was huge for us and for our nation. And I think what you'll see from my perspective is this is the driving force. This was done on 29 May 2009. I was going to actually have a cutout of me standing next to him. But some of you might have remembered the speech, and I wasn't there. So I thought, okay, so that probably wouldn't be right. But then you'd say, well, he's cyberspace. So here's a few key things that he said in this. First, cyberspace is real, and so are the risks that come with it. The cyber threat is one of the most serious economic and national security challenges we face as a nation. And finally, protecting the digital infrastructure is a national priority. So there's the President. This was the first speech done by a president on cybersecurity, pointing the vector ahead. Key to our economy, key to our national security, and we've got to do something about it. And I think that's what Senator Whitehouse and Congressman Langevin are talking about, and we appreciate that. So let me take this to the next step. Based on that, what our Deputy Secretary of Defense did was wrote an article for the Foreign Affairs magazine. And I don't want you to go back and read that necessarily. I just want to hit five key topics, and I'm going to talk about two of those because those are key to what we need to do. The first one was cyber as an operational domain analogous to air, land, sea, and space. The two I'm going to talk about are the active defense, the second one there, and the third one, extending that defense to critical infrastructure. Fourth, we do need partners. Government, within government as a team, between government and industry, and with our allies. And finally, I'm going to end up on, you know, we're the nation that built the internet. We're the nation that have built most of the tools. We ought to be the leaders in securing that. So let's talk about the active defense. If you look at how we defend our systems today, what we normally do is we have McAfee or Norton 360, and we put that up. And we tell our system administrators, here, you keep this up. You configure your network this way. It is very much a static capability. We'll upload new signatures. But this is the way it happens. This is the way we do it. We depend on each of you to do it right. And then somebody will come up with a new zero-day exploit. They'll break into the system. They'll get a bunch of hooks into that system, and they'll start taking data out. After a while, sometimes 6 to 10 months, somebody says something's wrong here. We find this new exploit. We beat the system administrator. We patch the system. Now, if you're not a system administrator, you're comfortable with this approach. This is analogous to the Maginot line. What we're doing is static. We have to do much more. We have to build that defense out. We have to have this go the full depth of what we can in cyberspace and do all of that. What would that entail? From my perspective, that includes an active capability inside your networks. Let's give the system administrators an active role and train them to be advanced network operators looking for the threats. The system that Steve Ryan built, we call tutelage. We've got to have a system that can communicate with inside the system and outside the system to know when we have a problem between industry, our allies, and our systems. How do we give early warning in cyberspace? A new concept. But that's something that you would logically do, and we should do it here. So we've got to build this out. We've got to have the capability to do that, and we've got to be able to move seamlessly to ward off those threats. So when you think about that, that means that we have to have a partnership between the Defense Department and the Department of Homeland Security. In September 2010, Secretary Gates and Secretary Napolitano signed a memorandum of agreement that began that partnership, recognizing that we can't afford to build another national security agency, that we would need to leverage what NSA has, not only for U.S. Cyber Command, but also for the Department of Homeland Security. I think that's a huge step forward. The second issue that I wanted to talk about was extending this to the critical infrastructure. Today, and oftentimes members of Congress will ask me, so how are you going to defend the country in cyberspace? Well, right now, that's not my mission. My mission as the commander of U.S. Cyber Command is to defend the military networks. That's what authority I have today. I do not have the authority to look at what's going on in other government sectors, nor what would happen to critical infrastructure. That right now falls to DHS. It also means that I can't stop it or in network speed see what's happening to it. What we do believe, though, is that that needs to be accounted for. We have to have a way of protecting critical infrastructure, like our power. And when you look at it, if you were to ask me to rank order where industries are in terms of their cybersecurity capability, I think power is at or close to the bottom of the list, not because they're bad, but because that's not a focus area for them right now. Not only that, they don't have the technical expertise nor the government help that they need, and we ought to give it to them. And so I think that partnership is going to be key for the future. So how do we extend this was one of the key things that Secretary Lynn talked about in that article, and I think that's a huge issue for our country. Now, when you think about it, one of the key things that comes up is about civil liberties and privacy. And here's why being here today is so important to us. My opinion, civil liberties and privacy are not at the expense of cybersecurity. They will benefit from cybersecurity, and we have to have a way of doing that. It means, from my perspective, accountability about what we're doing and oversight by Congress and by the administration. Technically, we can do that. We can do 100% audit and oversight, and I think that's something the American people should demand and that we should provide. On the other hand, it's not saying that, well, since we're concerned that NSA might touch that network, we can't secure it. I think the answer is no, we can do both, and we should. So the question is, how do we put those together? You know, I think it's also important. I've been at NSA almost 6 years. And you say, why so long? Well, they have a rule I found out is that you stay there until you do something useful. And so they said, you may be there for a long, long time. A great bunch of people. One of the most technically proficient workforces I have ever seen. One of the key things that I got when I got up there was how they protect our civil liberties and privacy. Every member of our workforce is required to go through training on handling U.S. persons' data and protecting it. And every time we take or make a mistake, we self-report to Congress, and to the administration. We take it very serious. We know what you're asking of us and what you're giving us to do in our intelligence roles is huge, and that you demand and should demand that we have accountability in this area. And I will tell you, it is my privilege and honor to supervise these people to be their leader, because they do it better than anybody else. Absolutely superb. I wanted to end on a couple things here. You know the four folks around the outside, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Sergey Brin, and Mark Zuckerberg. Key leaders today, everybody knows those, probably on the wealthy side. I thought it was interesting to look at Grace Hopper, the one in the middle, was one of the people, one of the longest serving naval officers we had, used to walk around with a 30 centimeter wire and say, here's a nanosecond at the speed of light. She was one of the digital revolutionaries that we had. Absolutely superb. And the reason I really put this slide up is this, and it goes back to where we started. When you look at what our nation has been able to do in cyberspace, it's extraordinary. We should be hugely proud of what this represents, the hardware, the software, the social network capabilities, and what this means for our futures. You know, I have 13 grandchildren. Yeah, I know I'm not that old, I know. But I have 13 grandchildren. The average age seems to be about two or three. They are already on the network. At five, they're doing report. It's amazing what our children and our grandchildren will be able to do because of these capabilities. We're the nation that started the network. We're an innovation nation. We ought to be the nation that secures it. So with that, I say go Rams. So thanks, folks. Okay, we could turn the lights up, and I have time for some questions. If you make them really easy, remember I'm an Army officer. But I see we have some Air Force officers here that could answer them if they're advanced.
I can start by question. Just to get us started, I was wondering, sir, if you would speak a bit more about how we would, or if we should, more tightly couple your work at U.S. Cyber Command with the non-military aspects of this problem.
Well, I think that's a great question. How do we do that? That's a tough issue because this is a domain or analogous to air, land, sea, and space as we talked about, but it's also unique in that it's inside, outside, it's civilian, military, government, everybody depends on it. I think what we have to have is the ability to defend our nation in cyberspace. And clearly, Cyber Command is going to be expected to do part of that mission. We have to have the ability to move seamlessly when our nation is under attack, or if it ever is attacked in cyberspace, to defend it. How do we do that? That's got to be established. The mechanisms for doing that, the tactics, the techniques and procedures and the concepts have to be laid out and agreed to. And rules of engagement. Senator Whitehouse made some great points on this. The laws don't exist in this area. We have gone faster than laws and policies have kept up with. Do the rules of land warfare, how do you now apply those to cyber? What does that mean? During my Senate hearing, Senator Levin asked a similar question. So I'm going to give you the question he asked me in my answer. And it was, give me some cases for how this is going to work, because I don't really understand cyberspace and what your job will be. Start out with, you're in a war zone, military on military. So if you think about Iraq, future Iraq problem, you have a military element in Iraq fighting another military element there. Cyber capabilities on both sides in the future, and we would be authorized to use those to defend ourselves and to attack the enemy, just like you would in physical space. Where it becomes more complicated, let's say now the adversary uses a neutral state to launch his cyber attack. What authorities do you have to block it? There are, in the law of land warfare, authorities there. Do they now, how do they go to cyber? And perhaps most importantly, what does that mean when they use the U.S. networks and systems to launch the attack on the U.S.? How do we defend that? How do we set that up? How do we do that? Is there a way for disconnecting those systems quickly to defend our nation? We've got to solve those problems. And those are the problems that are going to come up the second and third cases. Please. Now, that's a great point. So let me give you some statistics on that, and I'm gonna take and make sure I try to do this exactly right, because I know things that I can't divulge here. I'm gonna put it in perspective. We call intrusion sets when we get something that gets into our network that comes from an adversary. We call them intrusion sets. And this actor or set of actors have this intrusion set, and here's how they normally operate. There are hundreds of intrusion sets out there. One intrusion set, not the most prolific, but just one of those, we see pulling data out globally that is 50 times greater than WikiLeaks every day. That's just one of those intrusion sets. So what you see and hear that's very public, we should stop that, and we should come up with a system to do that. And I think there's a way to fix the WikiLeaks problem and to better our cybersecurity. And what we would push out there is something like the thin virtual cloud environment with a better network security that audits who has access to data. So I think you can do both. But I do want to be clear, because WikiLeaks is the most visible, I don't think it's the most dangerous. I think both of them have to be addressed. There's another question over here.
Yeah. Standing in front of the microphone.
Should have noticed that. Yeah. Army guy, remember.
Stenography, right, clear sight. So the threat, first I wanted to thank Congressman and the Senator here and URI for this forum. It's a great opportunity to share some ideas. So the threat is distributed, decentralized, and operates over multiple timescales. When I walked through the hallway, I saw some great technology being developed here at URI, focus on reputation, pervasive forensics. What are some gaps that these students here, these future innovators, could begin to address and move out to help protect our nation?
Well, that's a great question. So let me give you a couple thoughts on that. For those that saw RSA, not just the exploitation, but what RSA has done is called two-factor authentication. I had to go look that up. But what it means is the ability to operate on the network securely between two sites. You know this for PayPal and other things like that. And that was developed by the three gentlemen, RSA initials, back in the mid-70s. How do we do one-to-many RSAs? Social networking sites, and ensuring that the people who get on the social network sites are who they are. So you need non-repudiation, you need identity management, and the one that's the biggest gap that we see is, how do you see cyberspace? How do you actually see what's in your network? For the Defense Department, this is a huge issue. We have 15,000 networks. Now, we need to drop those down, and we're working that. But if you think about that, draw that image up of those 15,000 and millions of different systems that are parts of those networks that we use to operate. Make one mistake in that network, and you give an adversary an opening. It is easier to scan for vulnerabilities than it is to defend. And so when you look at it, we have the scale changed. So there's two things. How do we change that scale to make the defense better? And how do we see what's going on in cyberspace? And we call that a common operational picture. So those two, plus network security and identity management, are going to be key issues for the future that we ought to look at. So that offers, some of the students could become the future RSA. by coming up with these ways of securing data. I think part of that is encrypting data at rest and ensuring that the keys aren't available on the network and things like that. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Please, way back. I really can't hear you. I'm really good, but not that good. I can't. Not here. Never.
I want to know about veterans' opportunities. I'm a veteran. I've been in this industry for 35 years. At the VA, I see a lot of people there that would love to help. What programs are there for us to help the cybersecurity industry?
Well, that's a good question. And I'm not sure of the answer to that off the top of my head. What programs are available for veterans to help in cybersecurity? I do know this. Let me change it if I could, because, you know, near and dear to my heart, in a few years, I will also be a veteran. We thank you, one, for what you've done for your country, and two, there are tremendous opportunities out there for you for education and other things to go on. Take advantage of that. And there are a number of companies and places out there that you can apply to get that. And the government is working with a lot of these industry partners to build our capabilities. So I think that's where I would start. So thanks. Thanks for your service. Well, a couple of questions. The question was on, it seems like most of the problems are coming from China, and what are we doing? What are they doing to address it, and what are we doing to address it? I just found out there's a lot of Chinese people in China. And when you look at it, we actually use this statistic. When you look, I think it's 1.3 billion Chinese. Their top 25% is more than the population of the United States. Now, just because most of the actions come from China doesn't mean that it's of Chinese origin. So that's one issue. So attribution is the real key to the question that you're asking. How do we attribute and how do we know? The second part of that is a much more difficult problem set. And the calculus goes something like this. Let's say that we know that they're doing this and that they know that we know, you know? I didn't mean it to get that complex, but if you think about it, if we know they're trying to do something, that means we've captured one of their signatures. If you think about the signature and the way that we actually identify these signatures, changing those signatures is relatively easy versus finding them. And so the question is, how do we address that and what do we force on China? What do we force on ourselves and what about the rest of the world? Because other countries are involved too. My personal thoughts on this is, first, before we go throw any rocks, we ought to make sure we have our cyber defense stood up and ready. We ought to speak from a position of strength that says, hey, we need to start fixing this. And we do have a number of problems in our cybersecurity. So I think right now, if we say we know you're doing A, they'll deny it and then change it so that you lose it. We've had great experience doing that in the past, and all it has done is caused us to have gaps in tracking the threat. So step one, let's fix our defense. That's our priority, and we can do this. I think there are some technical initiatives out there, and we have great technical leaders in our country, those pictures that are up here and what you do here at this university, that can help us address that. So that would be my thought on going on that. I kind of answered that obliquely. Other questions? Please.
Thank you, General Alexander, for your leadership on this issue, and thank you to our congressional delegation. I think it's quite unique that we have such a small state, but one so rich in terms of leadership and capability, anxious to serve in this area. I wanted to ask you about the fourth element of Secretary Lynn's article, where he talks about internet cooperation. And I want to go beyond just cooperation interagency and talk about what needs to be done internationally. What do we need to do in terms of building norms and or potential collaboration? Difficult as it is because of our offensive capability, what needs to be done internationally to advance cybersecurity?
Well, that's a great question. Number four on the list was international cooperation engagement, allies. Let me just give you some where my thought comes down, my first thought. If you take a map, and Telegeographic, I think, has a great map, and I think I said it right, that you can get on the internet that shows the cables. Unclassified, just look at them. That's how light flows around the planet. And if you look at it, I think today, roughly, 18 of those cables coming from Europe, 12 of them come from the United Kingdom. So let's use that example. Two-thirds our traffic coming from the Eastern Seaboard, coming from the UK. So it would seem for us as part of our active defense methodology that we'd ask them to make sure that stuff coming through those cables can't hurt us. And they say, well, this cable's two ways. I just found that out. So, oh, so they probably say the same to us. Well, we really appreciate that, and we'd like you to police up your cables too. And if you think about that, there you can begin to set up standards and rules for that flow where it touches land, where people have authority over those cables to ensure they aren't used for those kinds of problems. That would be one of the things. The second, I do think we should, with our allies, share threat signatures. Now, there's two sets of threat signatures, those that are publicly available and those that the intelligence community and others may have found. The problem with the intelligence community sharing those is they're classified. And if you share them widely, then the adversary, going back to your earlier question, knows about them and they change them quickly. So you have to have a way of sharing those signatures in a classified form. I think that then gets to Congress and State Department and others. So how do we set up those partnerships with those countries to protect that? I think you brought out a great question on norms. What are norms? What is expected behavior? How should we police our own systems? What does it mean to have a sick system? You know, you can't drive without headlights. I found this out last night. No, that's a joke. I didn't. I was just kidding. Just kidding. If you can't drive cars with certain safety problems, should we allow those same computers on the network with safety issues? Is that a norm? Is that a national norm or an international norm? And so those starts to get into the debate. And how do we help people that do this? My mother's 83 years old. She has one of my computers, my old computer at home. If we told her to do something on that computer, it ain't going to happen. You know, she can turn it on, she can get email, she can send email. But if you want to go beyond that, we got a problem. So how do we make this go across all of our citizens to handle that? I think those are key issues that we have to form. So thanks. Thanks for that question. Please. Great question. The question was, for those in the back, is what role do terrorists have in attacks on our infrastructure? First, terrorists operating in cyberspace, our unclassified assessments is they actually operate on about 4,000 different websites, but their capabilities are at the lower end of the spectrum today. But as you know, moving from the low end of the spectrum to a higher point on that spectrum is not a huge time lag. So my concern is what today might be a nation state capability in 18, 24, 36 months could be a terrorist capability or an individual actor. And so that's a huge concern and one of the reasons that we're pushing this so hard. You have to get out in front of that. Next question, please.
General, what about our offensive capability? Does that come under you also? Because I would imagine there'd be some synergies between the two lessons learned.
It does. Great synergy. Let me be a little bit more transparent. You know, if you think about it, the best defense is made by having your offense help your defense. And so what we've done is we've brought our defense and offense together. One of the things that, you know, everybody says, well, you're an intel guy, you're not going to give this up for the defense. Actually, it's just the opposite. If we can help defend the nation, that is our top priority, period. Our offense, we have some great capabilities. And the issue is now, how do we take those great capabilities and ensure our nation's defensive capabilities benefit from that? We can do that with Cyber Command and the military networks. And that memorandum of agreement with DHS allows us to start working with DHS to do that. And the issue is now, how do we share that expertise with critical infrastructure to ensure they're protected at the same level? And so I do think you want to have those two partner together. What we did in 2005 is we built the NSA Threat Operations Center to bring the offense and defense together for just that reason. And out of that, another program that was spawned was called the Advanced Network Ops Teams. And they're the ones that found that problem on our classified networks. So I think there are some great things like that. So you would think of this as probably the best people to get to defend your system are the hackers that come out of there. Yes, with discipline and with a mathematic base. When you think about it, you know, I'm impressed by how much is based on mathematics in this area. We have our nation's center of gravity for crypto mathematicians. We have about 800 PhDs. And when you put all that talent together, that's how you discover vulnerabilities, problems, and solutions. A huge step for our country. So I think I can take one more question. Please. And I'll tell you if I could or not after the question.
General, I'm kind of curious. Assuming a lot of these things seem very long-term to me, assuming that a group of nation states were so inclined and could be that cohesive, what's the worst that they could actually do to America, say, next week?
Well, I've been told not to scare people. Boo. What's technically possible? Well, take down the power grid, the stock exchange, and the internet for a while. And when you think about it, that's a huge problem because services, communications, governments depend on those. They're vulnerable. I don't think any nation out there right now wants to attack us, but we still have these vulnerabilities and we've got to address them. These are significant problems. I think the president hit it on the head. This is a national security issue and we've got to address it. It impacts both our economy and our national security. Now, as part of the military, I don't have a lot of money, so if they hit Wall Street, it wouldn't impact me. But those of you who have a 401k or something like that, or others, yeah, it would be huge for our country. These are huge issues. And we look backwards at how wars have been fought. I think what we now need to do is say, what could people do to us in this area and how do we secure it? And the answer lies in audiences like this and in schools like this, because you're the future. You're the folks that are looking out to this. You're the ones that will come up to those with those solutions, the future RSA solutions, the future network security, the future common operational picture for cyber. And we need that. Our nation needs that. We developed the network and all those capabilities, or a lot of those capabilities. We ought to be the first ones to secure it, and we ought to move out on that quickly. So thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity to come in.
Thank you, General. Again, that was just a great talk. And, you know, I was a kid. When I was 17, I actually joined the Navy. And so with my background, there's no way I was going to cut off a four-star general, even though we're running a bit late. That was just a wonderful presentation, sir. Thank you very much. So at this time, I'd like to invite the panel to our first session to come to the stage. And the process that we will follow throughout the three panel discussions is that first we will hear from the representatives of federal agencies and the federal departments who present a national perspective on the session theme. Second, we will hear from a representative from industry who will present the corporate perspective on that theme. And then lastly, we'll hear from URI faculty and graduate student researchers who will discuss how URI's unique research capabilities in a wide range of cyber-related areas can impact on the panel theme and other outstanding issues of the day. The first panel of the day is on cyber threats to critical infrastructure, and will be chaired by Professor Yan Sun from the Department of Electrical, Computer, and Biomedical Engineering. And let me just tell you something very briefly about Professor Sun. She has received two very prestigious awards from the Natural Science Foundation. The first is the NSF Cyber Trust Award, and the second is the NSF Career Award. And when I say prestigious, these are indeed very, there's just a small number of these awards that occur each year. Her own research interests are in the areas of network security, trustworthy social computing, wireless networking, and security and biomedical systems. So I will now ask Dr. Sun if she would please begin this session and introduce the members of your panel.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Even before my talk, it's my great pleasure to introduce a panel on cyber threats to critical infrastructures. We're responding to General Alexander's talk right now. So on this panel, we're very proud to have Dr. Douglas Mao from the Department of Homeland Security and Theresa Murray from Rhode Island Emergency Management Agency. Dr. Douglas Mao is a division director in Homeland Security Advanced Research Project Agency. He is directing the cybersecurity research and development activities. Prior to his appointment to DHS, Doug was a program manager at DARPA, where his where his research interests and related programs were in the area of networking and information assurance. And before that, he also worked for National Security Agency. He will be the first speaker. Our second panelist is Theresa Murray. He is a regional catastrophic planner at Rhode Island Emergency Management Agency. What does she do? She is a coordinator overseeing the regional planners covering 39 communities in Rhode Island for the development of emergency operation plans, continuity of operation plans, and the dam emergency action plans. And today he will tell us cyber disruption efforts in Rhode Island. So Doc, your turn.
Thank you, and I appreciate the opportunity to follow three great speakers and hope to be able to hit a grand slam as the fourth speaker. What I wanted to talk about was to give you a flavor of some of the cybersecurity activities, in particular in the research and development area, that are going on within the U.S. government. If you're not familiar with something called the Comprehensive National Cybersecurity Initiative, or CNCI, you should become familiar with it. It is what is driving cybersecurity in Washington these days. It was originally put forward by the Bush administration and has been supported and pushed even further by the Obama administration, but it includes 12 major focus areas, and I'm going to talk about a few of them today, but there's plenty of information on the Comprehensive National Cyber Initiative off of whitehouse.gov. I do want to talk about four areas. First is the bottom right, which is in cybersecurity for critical infrastructure. That'll be the bulk of my presentation. I will also touch briefly on the top right, which is in R&D coordination, and the bottom left, which is in new R&D topics. And then I will also touch briefly on the middle right, which is education, which I believe was also touched by several of the speakers. So first, let's talk about critical infrastructure. So as many of you may be familiar, we've all been living with business systems for a long time. And it's only been in the last few years that we've started taking our critical infrastructure systems and trying to do the same thing with them that we've had with our normal business systems. And in fact, control systems for critical infrastructure are very different than what we would normally think of in our traditional business systems. Things like power systems require 24/7 operation, high reliability and availability. They're less concerned about confidentiality. And many of the past generations of control system technologies, legacy systems, haven't required significant computing power. As we move forward to the smart grid, if you're familiar with that, and other types of technologies, the reliance on higher computing systems is going to be tremendous. We're also, latency is unacceptable. We have to have real-time control, and last is mandatory response. From the energy sector, which is the sector-specific agency for the control system environment, they have several challenges that they're trying to work through, and I'll talk about on the next slide a roadmap that has been built. But if you think about it, they've listed five here, and I'm representing a little bit the Department of Energy as the lead agency. But we are concerned with some of the open protocols. You have to ask yourself the question, isn't that better than proprietary protocols? And then a lot of times it is, but then you're dealing with interoperability and making sure that vendors' products work the same way. We also know that there is a problem with a common operating system. Oftentimes the monoculture will cause us problems as it has done in the past. There is the interconnection problem with control systems. As I mentioned in the previous slide, more and more of these systems are connected to the internet for various reasons of information sharing, and so now they become vulnerable. Last is external communication, or fourth is external communication, a serious reliance on external communications that they didn't have before. And then as we look for, just as General Alexander talked about, you know, everybody with their iPhones and their iPads, et cetera, we are going to have the same issue, if you will, in the critical infrastructure. More and more wireless devices, and now how do you ensure that those are secure going forward? So what has been produced to date has been something called a roadmap to secure control systems in the energy sector, led by the Department of Energy, and it's out and available. But the vision for this roadmap was to really look at, and this was done in 2006, and the idea was, you know, control systems with critical applications that are going to be designed and installed and be able to maintain and survive in the face of an attack. And this requires more than just government involvement. Obviously, we don't build the control systems of the future. Private sector builds those. So the roadmap has been a true partnership, public and private, over the last 5 years. And it really points to four specific areas within control systems. One is to be able to measure and assess our current security posture. General Alexander made some really interesting comments about the fact of his mother and her system and whether or not it's clean and on the internet. And we do have this problem of we can't tell how sick many of our systems are. We cannot actually measure them and tell whether they're in good health or whether they're not in good health. The goal here is that by 2015, that within the energy sector, be able to have that ability and be able to monitor those systems. Second is new protective measures. As I said, the vision here is for a next generation of control systems that are secure by design and by deployment and not security bolted on afterwards. We have to improve the security technologies that are going into those systems for intrusion detection and response. As the general said, it's not enough to be able to detect. We do have to be able to take action at some point. And last is just ensuring that those security improvements are sustained. I wanted to step into the next piece of the control system or the infrastructure and talk a little bit about DHS. So as some of you may be familiar, in Washington, DHS, we're now, I think, effective March 1st. We're 8 years old, so we're still I guess we're not a toddler anymore, but we're certainly not a preteen. But DHS over the last year went through a process of defining what they call their quadrennial Homeland Security Review. And during that review, there were five major missions that were designated by DHS for DHS. One of those missions was securing cyberspace, mission number four. As part of science and technology's mission, our job is to support the department. We're really focused in two areas: knowledge products, which essentially ends up being reports and standards and things like that, and innovative technologies. This comes to the point of answering Owen's question about how do we create new technologies? How do we help the new innovators that are here as students today and help them understand and become the Googles of tomorrow? And for those of you not familiar with the Homeland Security Enterprise, it's a new term that was coined as part of the Quadrennial Homeland Security Review. But essentially, the Homeland Security Enterprise is no longer just federal, state, and local. It includes private sector. It includes Joe and Jane Citizen. It includes the international partnership. All of that is now in the Homeland Security Enterprise, which means DHS mission has actually grown in the last year, much broader than it was previously. So what I want to talk about is our R&D model. And the model is key in making sure that we produce technologies. First is in requirements. We are a requirements-driven research organization. We don't just do blue sky research. It's really about customers, internal DHS customers, such as National Cybersecurity Division, Secret Service, and others, national documents, such as the National Strategy and the White House Cyberspace Policy Review. But in the case of critical infrastructure, we do take in requirements from private sector organizations. Those requirements, we talk about them, we put workshops together, we put roadmaps together, but essentially that feeds an R&D program within DHS. I'm not going to talk about all these programs. I'll certainly be willing to chat with folks. I'll be around all day if people have specific interest. But the difference maker for DHS is on the back end. I've been in the research establishment of the government for over 20 years, and we have seen no end of technologies that have been funded and then put on the shelf to collect dust and never make it out into the commercial marketplace. We have to change that, as the General mentioned, and I think even as Representative Langevin pointed out. It's all about innovation and creating the technologies and getting those technologies out and into the marketplace and securing our systems. So we focus very heavily on two things. One, putting technology into operational environment and putting in front of the fire hose to see how it stands up to the pressure, and to make sure that it in fact will survive. The second is to do outreach and work with venture community and others investing that will invest in the technology. We, the government, aren't going to be the ones to sustain and maintain technologies that come out of a university. You need a company to back that technology. You need large system integrators to bring that technology in and incubate it and make sure that it will last. And we try to make those, if you will, marriages happen to ensure long-term sustainability of those technologies. We call that our Cybersecurity R&D Center, and we run it out of DHS. Let me talk a little bit about critical infrastructure and where we're focusing our efforts. First is, I believe the most critical infrastructure of all is in the internet itself. DHS Science and Technology has been leading the initiative in the government over the last 6 years to do two things. One is securing the domain name system. Every time you go online, you're using this system. You are at risk of being redirected to fake websites. We've been working with the government to have the U.S. government take a lead in the deployment of DNS and DNSSEC. And second is to work with the vendor community and to ensure that there are products out there for businesses and governments to acquire to start to secure their infrastructure. Probably the most important announcement in DNS security came at the end of March when VeriSign announced that they've actually signed the .com domain, and we hope to see significant uptake within the community at this point. Second is in routing. If you haven't noticed several stories in the last couple of years on the routing side of things, everything from the YouTube Pakistan attack to a couple of Chinese ISP misconfigurations over the last year. But we are working with the major router vendors, the major ISPs, to ensure that we have solutions going forward in this marketplace. We're very focused in another critical infrastructure in the finance sector. So we have a project called Decide. It's essentially, think about the finance sector. Their goal is to exercise risk management every day. they don't have the tools available as a sector. You might have a single finance entity that will have this kind of a tool. It's their competitive advantage. They're not going to share it necessarily with their competitors. So what we've done is we're working with, as you can see, a number of the organizations there, Chicago First, Options Clearing Corporation, Eurex, Archipelago, Bank of New York, Citibank, to develop an exercise tool where they can do risk management exercises every day to ensure that their infrastructure is as secure as it can be. The key thing here is they're providing their people at no cost to this project, which is, again, a public-private partnership. Everybody has to have skin in the game to ensure that we move forward. Additionally, in the finance sector, just in December, with the support of the White House, we signed a memorandum of understanding between DHS, NIST, and the Finance Sector Coordinating Council for R&D projects, and then specifically two. One is in DNS security, which I've already discussed, and two is in identity management, which General Alexander mentioned briefly at the end of his presentation. Two key areas that the finance sector believes they have to solve going forward. Another critical infrastructure is oil and gas. So we have a joint project with the oil and gas guys. They came to us and said, we don't do cybersecurity, we do oil and gas. Help us out. So we've helped them create an organization called Logic. There's a URL there, you can go for more information. But essentially what it amounts to is an agreement between five of the super major oil companies. It allows them to do pre-competitive collaborative R&D with the support of the government. And essentially, they put their projects on the table, they put their money on the table, and we help them manage it. And in the end, the goal here is to raise the bar for the entire oil and gas sector, not just the five companies that are at the table today. And the last I want to talk about is the electric sector and a project called TCIPG. This is a joint project between the Department of Energy and DHS Science and Technology. It's all about the trustworthy power grid of the future. So let's look at how we create, as the vision was outlined in the 2006 roadmap, how do we create the next generation control system or cyber infrastructure for the power grid? What is the smart grid going to look like? We're all going to have our electric cars that are going to plug into our house, and our house is going to be metered and monitored, and you're going to make sure that that's all secure, right? So the key thing here, I believe, is the fact that as part of this project, there's an advisory board of 30-plus private sector companies. Why? Because the university, which is this is led out of the University of Illinois, and the government are not going to be the ones to make this a reality. We have to have the private sector, those vendors who are going to build the technologies, those asset owners and operators who are going to deploy the technologies at the table to start with, so we ensure that what gets built, in fact, will be deployed. Here's the website, tcip.org. You can take a look. It's a fairly active website. It's only been live for a couple of months now. This project's only about since the 1st of October, so about 8 months old. A couple of projects that I think are key. One is the analysis of the smart grid, and more interesting, it's not a computer science or an electrical engineering or a mathematics problem. It's an economics problem, right? So as we look to the future, we have to think about, in the cybersecurity world, non-technical, if you will, and more social science types of issues. So they're actually looking at the economic impacts of new types of electric supply, wind resources, demand response, et cetera. And the goal here, again, is new technologies and getting them out and getting them into the marketplace. Second area is in test beds. So we can't do what we do with the control systems and with electric power on the real electric grid. We saw that doesn't work as the attack in 2003 took out the Northeast. So what we're building are environments where researchers, so, you know, the researchers here at URI, we would like nothing more to have some of those students have access to a real control system. How are we going to teach the next generation about power systems and about how to secure those systems if we can't give them access to real power, real control systems? So we're actually working there to build mechanisms for researchers anywhere in the country to have access to real control systems that sit at some of the national labs. And the third area is in education and engagement. There's a wonderful poster back on the filing cabinet back there that says, ignorance is dangerous, get educated. And I think, as I think both Representative Langevin and Senator Whitehouse said, one of the key functions of the future is our education and the next generation. As I look out over the crowd, and as General Alexander said, he's going to be retired soon. So are a lot of the rest of you. And where's our next generation? And we have to educate them. So as part of the TCIPG project, we've actually built little applets that are available to junior high and high school kids to use and to learn about these types of systems. We do have an education problem. If you haven't seen the statistics, the enrollments in computer science, computer education are down 50%, yet the job market is the fastest growing job market in the country. And so computer science and STEM is even more important than it has been in the past. As part of that, the administration has announced something called the National Initiative for Cyber Education. It's out and available for more information if you'd like. We're very focused in the second one, which is education in the K-12 and undergraduate area. Last but not least, I just want to touch base on research. Those of you that are the researchers, there is a research agenda that has been announced by the administration. It will actually be published in May and coming out at the IEEE Security Conference in Oakland and then published off of the White House at that point. But there's also been an answer to Owen's question from earlier, you know, if you want to do work in this area, what problems do we have? Well, we DHS have released our own roadmap for cybersecurity research. It's available there on our website, has 11 topics, all of which complete solutions to. We may never have complete solutions to, but in fact, these are some significant areas where people can start to spend important intellectual capital to try to solve these problems. I'll leave that, that website is there again. I'll be there here all day if people have questions. So let me just say that there are many U.S. government efforts focused on securing critical infrastructure for the future. As I believe both Representative Langevin and General Alexander said, the infrastructure, and in particular the internet infrastructure and the critical infrastructure, is our future. We're in the information economy going forward. We have a very aggressive cybersecurity R&D agenda, which is, we believe, a key piece to the solution. We have to fund the new innovations, we have to fund the new ideas, and get those out there as infrastructure, and make sure that we transition those things into operational environments. Thank you very much.
Cyber technical difficulties. Good morning. My name is Theresa Murray, and I'm a regional catastrophic planner with the Rhode Island Emergency Management Agency. I'm here today to talk to you about our regional catastrophic efforts and our state cyber disruption efforts that we have been working on here in the state since 2009. The key to emergency management is to exchange business cards in advance of an emergency and to have a coordinated effort on any incident that may occur. And that's what we're trying to do here in the state with regard to cyber disruption. Our state emergency operations plan needed revision, and we began that in 2009. When we did that, there are 15 emergency support functions that go along with that emergency operations plan. Emergency support function number 2 deals with communications, and at that time, DHS incorporated cyber response into the communications ESF2.
with that, we coordinate with the telecommunications and also the IT industries. We have worked along the lines of ESF2 with developing a cyber disruption support annex to the state EOP, which will outline organizations' actions and responsibilities involved with any cyber disruption effort in the state. The cyber disruption annex identifies stakeholder roles and responsibilities, and the key to it is to have a rapid response to restore service to the people of the state of Rhode Island, as well as to mitigate any damage caused by a disruption. The framework is utilized in any emergency, whether it's a significant cyber threat, a disruption, or a cyber attack. As part of this, I have been working very closely with the Rhode Island State Police Computer Crimes Unit, who have been instrumental in working in the development of this plan and also of a cyber disruption team here in the state. We have been doing awareness briefings. We've begun them and they will continue throughout the year. We plan to do them with the Chambers of Commerce. We've already presented to the Emergency Management Advisory Council. We hope to meet with private businesses. We've already presented to the Rhode Island Association of Emergency Managers. And the key to that is to bring an awareness of the potential threats. Many of the major businesses in the state have pretty developed actual disaster recovery plans and resiliency plans in their continuity of operations plans. We're trying to bring that to the state government and the local governments so that they have an awareness and they do risk assessments and check their vulnerabilities in their local systems so that we ensure that our state is up and running in the event we have a disruption in service. Our team is going to be selected later this week. We had a workshop earlier in March, and we brought together members of the higher education, defense contractor, financial industry, and hospital representatives. We are having a team selection meeting later this week on April 14th at State Police Headquarters. Some of the partners who have played a role in our cyber development, cyber disruption plan development, and also identifying cyber disruption team members are listed here. Many of them have already been at multiple meetings in the state, and others we hope to have incorporated in meetings in the future. Many of these on the second page are federal partners, and many of them have also come to the table. We were very fortunate under a regional catastrophic grant program to receive funds to help us focus and assist us with the development of our cyber disruption plan as well as our cyber disruption team. And that is a coordination of Rhode Island, Massachusetts, and New Hampshire. It involves 34 local jurisdictions and two urban area security initiatives. The map here shows you the area that that covers. There is also a regional catastrophic coordination cyber plan, and that is going to be tested later this month on April 27th. Under the regional catastrophic program, we're also able to do state cyber disruption exercises, and we have our first one for this scheduled for this Wednesday on April 13th. Bless you. We are very focused in all of our efforts are dealing with the state's cyber resilience. And as part of this, I wanted to make you aware of a DHS program that's being offered, and they're called Cyber Resilience Reviews. And they will come out and conduct a one-day survey in a business or government and help identify vulnerabilities, whether it involve your software, hardware, personnel, contract personnel that you have, to identify any weaknesses and help you to strengthen your cyber effort, your cyber functioning in your business or government. And the website is up here, and I do have some handouts that I'll leave on the table later about that, but I'm trying to go through this rather quickly because I know we stand between you and lunch, but I will take any specific questions once Yen is finished with her talk. So I thank you for your time.
As you notice, we run behind the schedule, so I was just told we'll now have the Q&A session. Instead, please catch us speakers during the lunch. We'll be available whole day. So I'm the only one between you and your lunch. So we have heard that power grid is vulnerable. So in this talk, I would like to discuss a specific project we have done at URI, and this is to secure U.S. power grid. But I would like to first share with you some stories. The Wall Street Journal reported in 2009, the cyber spies have penetrated the U.S. power grid. They left softwares behind. At that time, they didn't aim to damage the network, but if they wanted, they could. They could activate those softwares. And then last year, New York Times reported a story, is an academia research article published in a foreign country. In the article, the authors discussed how to cause cascading failures in U.S. power grid. That set off alarm. And a recent article in published in Nature, they demonstrated how the cascading failures occur in both power grid and our communication networks. I'm going to show you a figure here. On the left-hand side, you see the red dots that represent this a single one power station's knockdown. And then this part here is a communication network, our internet. And then because of a power failure, there will be failures in the communication networks. And then those failures will propagate to large portion of networks, both in communication networks and power grid. On the left-hand side, you will see the final result of cascading failure. But how could cascading failure occur? This is very complicated. I will just give you a very simple model. It's like this. You have an attacker come in, knock down one substation, which is a node in your network. And then the load carried by this substation will not disappear. It will be redistributed to other nodes. So other nodes has to carry extra load. That could cause overloading. And overloading, in turn, will cause failures of more nodes, and which cause more load to be redistributed to other nodes, and more overloading, and this effect continue, and you have cascading failure. And the behavior of cascading failure is very complicated. This example has been mentioned two times already, so I won't go through the details, but as you know, it's really caused by a few power transmission line failure. This accident is due to it's occasionally, it's not a malicious attack, but you can imagine attackers could do the similar thing. Okay, it's not easy, it's not difficult to disable the power transmission line. So the research community as well as industry is pushing the concept of smart grid. Can the smart grid solve the security problems? The answer is yes and no. Yes, if we can understand how cascading failures occur, and if we can catch the signal of the cascading failure and estimate and detect the cascading failure in the early stage. That's two big ifs. And then dynamic control in a smart grid can help us to detect cascading failures and try to help us to stop cascading failures. However, on the other hand, because in smart grid we have a lot of dynamic control, that means communication of the control messages. It opens doors for cyber attacks. In cyber attacks, attacker can manipulate those control messages. They can change or delay those control messages. So if the smart attackers can combine physical attack in which they take down a transmission line or substation and the cyber attack, and our power grid will be much more vulnerable. So at URI, there are many challenges out there. At URI, what we do, our first step to solve those challenges is to put our shoes, kind of study the problem from the attacker's perspective. What is the best attack strategy? To answer those questions, the answer to those questions actually help us to understand the vulnerability of the power grid. To make it very brief, I just tell you, in the traditional system, traditional research literature, people always think about attacker will take down the node with the largest load. That is reasonable. However, in our research, we discovered that that is not the most powerful attack strategy. We discover new metrics and new methods that will help the attacker to identify the most vulnerable parts of the network. Some of the metrics is related to the risk assessment. And without getting into the details, I just show you some results we have. Tested against the Western North American Power Grid Network, which contains over 4,000 nodes, and we compared three attack strategies. The first attack strategy is random attacker randomly select the power station and knock it down. And the vertical axis is a damage. You can see that the red line. And then we can also attack our attacker can also pick the node which is, has the largest load and take it down. And that is represented by the blue line. It caused some damage, it's not a severe damage yet. But if attacker use our proposed method, they can cause a damage which is represented by the green line, it should cause a much more severe threat to the network. So right now, we just discussed the attacker knock down single node. How about attacker can knock down multiple nodes at the same time? And how about attacker can do a sequential attack, which means they not only knock down multiple nodes, they carefully coordinate which one to knock down first, which one to knock down second. So there's a timing here. And also, attacker could be also, and also we'll study how could attacker combine the physical attacks and the cyber attacks. But alternatively, we're not going to only deliver attack solutions. We want to deliver is defense solutions. How to defend against such smart attacks in a smart grid. And also we'll deliver tools that will be the test bed to test the proposed research and also visualization tools to help the decision makers to look at the power grid and understand where are the vulnerabilities. So that concludes my talk. It's short. Yeah, really good.
Well, I know they're standing between us and lunch, but we do have a very sensitive fact that we have people that travel some distance, particularly from the Department of Homeland Security. And I, for one, wouldn't mind taking a few minutes, and then we can cut it out of our lunchtime if we have to. But I wonder if we have many questions for our guests, either from DHS or for from the State REMA office. Hey, can we have the lights on, please? Yep. Yes, sir.
That's it for me? Well, I can take a stab at this and tell you that in Rhode Island, we're working, as I mentioned earlier, with the state computer, state police computer crimes unit. So they are ready and able to gather evidence, and certainly we would call in the FBI as needed. But we are coordinating with National Grid here in the state, and we will deal with prioritizing restoration of service with the grid based on some of their already existing plans and identification of those that we find as critical infrastructure here in the state that need service restored. The state police would coordinate with the grid, and that's the key to bringing them together on our cyber disruption team so that those things can be worked out in advance of any disruption effort here in the state. But we are at the beginning stages of that, so I can't answer for them at this point.
Can I say a few words? From the research perspective, we have a technology, not technology, concept called slowing things down. If you know something's happening, you're not sure about it. Maybe it's too early to cut the affected area, but you can slow things down such that the attack will not evolve so quickly.
Yes, sir.
The
the threat is real today, but yet it takes a couple of years to develop solutions in those relationships to operationalize. So my question is, if you could, DHS, some people could provide some examples of how a university like Rhode Island can develop those relationships over time to go after these long-term, develop long-term strategies to start to operationalize some of these solutions.
I think there are several options you can think about. First is venture capital. So there's the VCs are coming back to the table. They now want to invest. So I think, you know, partnering with your business school, right? So a computer science and a business person, now I start talking about how do I take the technology that's developed in the lab and spin it out as a commercial partnership. Second is, I think Representative Langevin mentioned it, you have a very significant defense industrial base here in the state. We have several examples of defense industrial base customers who have partnered with either universities or small businesses to create technology that is now commercially available. So, I mean, I think it's, you're only bounded by your creativity. There are plenty of people that I think can help in commercializing. It's hard getting out of the university. I can tell you that because we've tried it and we've successfully done it several times, but we failed several times as well. But I think it's doable.
Any other questions? Again, I'd like to thank our guests for coming today for the very interesting sessions.